Good morning, Haus Church, and good afternoon to Haus Church over in Germany and in DRC right now. We don't have the Reedsons with us because sadly they had one of the church members, they're attending a funeral. But I do want to say, and this is the good news of life, God gives us life so that even though we may die, we rise again because of the resurrection. These are like Easter lilies. It's not Easter, and they're not Easter lilies, but they are lilies.
Oh, I love them.
And they smell absolutely fantastic.
Thank you, Joan.
Thank you, Joan, and for the card as well. So, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Our opening prayer this morning is from Tom Thompson in Colorado. Tom?
Good morning, everyone. Let's pray together. Dear Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day that you've given us. Thank you for another opportunity to live life the way you want us to. Help us each one, Father, to do the right things as we come across situations. Be with each person here. You know the needs, the joys of everyone here, Lord, and I just ask that you would touch these lives and work in them, strengthen them. Be with Bart this morning as he brings us your word. Guide him, give him wisdom, Lord. Help us to hear, open our hearts and minds that we can understand what you want us to learn. Thank you again, Lord, for every blessing that you provided. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Okay, I got a bright spot. So I volunteer with Adrian and Pat and Joan at the Naval Academy every Thursday. And for about the last year, especially since Bart's decided to do this Samaritan Perk thing, I thought, you know, I need to find one more area because I like to keep my days super busy when he's gone. So I went to a picnic on Monday, and one of the ladies there also works where we work, and she was complaining about how much work they have on Tuesdays. And I was thinking to myself, maybe I'll go in on Tuesdays and help there. But the problem is that this woman has a terrible reputation for being rude, and nobody wants to work with her. But I thought, you know, I came home, I had this amazing peace of God that surpasses understanding. This is where I'm going to plant myself. So Tuesday morning, I went in, I opened the door, and she looked at me just like this. She goes, "What are you doing here?" Instantly, I was like, "Okay, God, I know you told me to come here. I'm going to do this." So I went into the back and I started working. And over the next 15 minutes, I heard, "We don't do it that way. I do that. You're doing it wrong. Why are you doing this?" And the person who's kind of the supervisor walked in and I said, "I need you to stay right here because I have something I have to say." And I couldn't believe how much courage I had because I hate confrontation. But I told this woman, I said, "From the minute I walked in here, you have been rude, condescending. You have treated me like," I said, I really don't even know why I came here, other than I know this is where I came to help you. I have come to help you." She got so angry. I said, "You know, you tell me to do this and we don't do it on Thursdays. And then you tell me to do this." And she got really mad and she yelled at her sister. She said, "Get your coat. We're leaving. We're out of here." And the other woman that's kind of our supervisor was just standing there. She didn't say anything. Isn't this a great bright spot? So I said, "Please don't do that. Please don't leave. I really want to help you." I kept saying, "I'm here to help you. Maybe we don't do it the same way." So I said, "Why don't you come over here and show me how you would like this done?" And we went through this whole process, and she turned to me afterwards and she said, "I just want you to know I'm really sorry." So I told Pat and Joan this, and they were like, "She said she was sorry? This woman is never wrong." Not only did she say she was sorry, but she asked for a hug. So I gave her a hug, and for the next 3 hours, we worked together. I got to know her. And at the end of the day, she came up to me and she said, I really want you to know that I'm very, very sorry how I treated you. And I said, and I want to apologize too for maybe being a little aggressive how I came at you. And I said, you know, and she said, can I have a hug? And I gave her a hug and I said, you know, we have the same father, because we were talking about our faith. And the amazing thing was, though, as I came home, and now I'm really excited. I'm a little fearful, I must be honest, going back in on Tuesday, because I don't know what I'm going to get. I hope she didn't forget. But I came home and I got a message from Patrick in Malawi. And the message was, I know Bart is gone, and I don't know why God wants me to pray for this for you, but I've asked him to give you courage this week. Isn't that an awesome bright spot?
That's a fantastic bright spot.
I love it.
So it's like, what?
You're like the being bullied on the playground and stood up to the bully, and you know?
See, Joan and Pat are both nodding.
I love it. Oh, I'm learning those things too, Dawn. I love it.
Now, yeah. One of the things Thank Dawn you. Said was we both have the same father. Well, we all have the same father. And this is Father's Day, where we honor those who are legitimate fathers on earth. And if you are, raise your hand so we can all acknowledge those who are fathers. Yeah, great.
Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day to all. But let's always remember, it's always Father's Day to our Lord. So we have a song. I'd just like you to listen to it. And one of the neat things about playing a song like I'm about to do, and it has to do with focusing in on the Father, is you can sing it. If you're alone by yourself, you can put yourself on mute. You can sing it like being in the shower. You can put yourself not on video and have a wonderful time doing that. So just listen in as we play the song.
I don't know where it is.
Yeah, right here.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shame.
The sound stopped.
There's no sound, Bart. No sound.
I see all I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto see all I have need. thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness,
Okay, thank you. I'm still learning how to do this. I thought I would mute myself so I could sing along and you wouldn't be able to hear me and really be distracted, only to find out that when I mute, since I'm recording, you can't hear anything. But you did hear most all of it, I hope, and you did see the words. So we're gonna have a little discussion time now, because we're focusing on Father's Day. My message is not on Father's Day, so I wanna give that the time and attention I think it deserves right now. What was most impressive to you with a father in mind from that song? Joe.
The faithfulness of the father.
Faithfulness of the Father, Joan. Yeah, you're unmuted. Nope, now you're muted. Nope, well, you're now muted. Now you need to unmute again. You were fine. There you go. Go ahead. No, Joan. Unmute.
He wants you to say something, Joan. There you
yes.
go.
Yes. Well, Joan.
All I have needed, right, your hand please. Has provided.
All I have needed, thy hand has provided.
Okay. Thy faithfulness, all I have needed, your hand has provided. With something else from that song? Joan, you can always put it in the chat.
Lord, unto me. He's faithful to me.
Okay. Let's think about our fathers, whether they're still living or not. Mine passed away back in 1999, so it's been a while. Whether you had mostly a good relationship or not, there are certain things, whether you really knew your actual father, maybe you were adopted and didn't know your birth father, but I'm talking about the one who you would call dad more than any other. The person that you would acknowledge as on earth, your dad. That song, Great is Thy Faithfulness, and all those other things about that father. Something, share something about your father, the one you call dad, as you're thinking of him right now.
Yeah. I'm proud of my father because if I am able to hear you, Bart and Don and everyone a little bit, and to speak English, it is because of my father who has provided for our family English training materials that I have been using for myself to learn English. And now I'm speaking English right now at Haus Church. It is because of my father who passed away more than 10 years ago now. He's to his soul, and I'm proud of him. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Fabian. Thank you.
One of the things I think about my father was he was always willing to talk to me and explain why he wanted something done instead of just saying, do it because I said to. He would tell me why it needed to be done. And if I had a problem, his insights were, to me, were very, very insightful. And I always appreciated that.
Thanks, Tom.
Now, my grandfather, this is Tawana. My grandfather was my father. And he was very faithful and kind. But when I think of him, I really do feel like I saw God in him. He's very, just the kindest man I've ever known.
Nice. When did he pass away, Tawana?
September 1999.
Oh, well, that was about the same time my dad passed away too. Yeah. And he would love to hear what you just said. And it makes me think of my own dad being there for me to encourage me in some of the different areas of life that he thought were important, like public speaking. There was a thing called the Optimist Oratorical Contest, and he made sure that my brother and I were in that. He wrote the speech, but I had to memorize it and give it, but it was his own, and I think it was his way of communicating through me, but I really value that attention and that time, and I thank my dad for giving me that.
I think Mike's talk. Mike, are you talking? You're muted.
Yeah.
Sorry. So one thing I've been thinking about my dad recently is something I just took for granted as a kid. There was a period where he took me to the library every week, and I would haul my little bundle of kids' books in, and he would carry his books in, and we'd turn in the books we'd read, and we would check out new books, and he would explain, you know, where the kid, I could look for kids' books. And then when I transitioned to older books, he would show me the areas and then talk about the authors. And then I would, you know, he would introduce me to certain books and I would read like the whole series. And so we had this whole conversation about reading that became a really, it became really important in my life. And it all happened without me even noticing. You know what I mean? Like, it looked effortless. But then when I think about what a poor job I did of taking my own daughter to the library, you know, now I see it as remarkable. And I think Flavian had a t-shirt on about reading. So he talked about the importance of his dad leaving him the English language materials.
Yeah.
Very nice. Thank you, Mike. Lynn.
Yeah, my dad passed away 8 years ago. And I was just thinking when you were talking that one of the things that really stands out in my mind is, you know, my recollection of him when I was younger is, you know, he's impatient, he's stubborn, he's, you know, whatever. But in later life, he became just, you know, completely the opposite. And one example, they came to visit me right after I moved to Annapolis, and my dad caught a cold. And when he got home, he couldn't taste or smell. And this was way pre-COVID. And it never, he never recovered that. But he was the most gracious person. Like, you know, when we'd all be together at dinner eating and my mom had cooked a great meal, you know, he would just say, "Honey, this is the best meal. This tastes delicious." And you almost forgot that he couldn't taste. But I mean, he was just amazing with things like that. And he just in his later life became so gracious about his, you know, kind of handicaps, health conditions and whatever. And it totally blew me away. Mm. So that's my little tale.
Thank you, Lynn. Let's have one more.
I have something.
That's right. Thank you, Dick.
My father died in 1994. And is buried over at the Naval Academy Cemetery. He spent many of his years in the Navy, graduated of the Naval Academy, spent 4 years in World War II, part of it in Europe and Africa, and part of it in the South Pacific. Even though he was very busy and he didn't always have a lot of time for me because of his job being so demanding, he was able to get me started fishing and trapping rabbits and hunting pheasants. To this day, I still do that sort of thing, although I can't do it as much as I used to. So those are my fond memories of my father.
Thank you, Dick. Well, maybe we'll have some time at the end to share some more stories, but thank you. This is the way for us not only to remember our fathers, those that we call dad, but also to get to know the fathers of one another. And that's another way of getting to know each other, which is so important. Well, it's our time for prayer. So I'm going to turn that over to Johnny for our prayer time.
Good morning, House Church. Happy Father's Day to all the dads. Let's pray together over these prayer requests and praises. Dear Lord, thank you for each person who's here with us today. I pray you bless each one. I pray for Bart as he speaks, and just thank you for giving us fathers. Dear Lord, we just praise you for Bart's week-long training at Samaritan's Purse headquarters in Boone, North Carolina. Lord, I just pray you bless all the future trips Bart takes with them. I prayed you for Johnny and Mary Miranda, who had a wonderful honeymoon and returned home safely. Thank you, Jesus, for keeping our missionary families in Malawi and DRC healthy and blessing their ministries. And we ask for continued blessings in those ministries, Lord. Lord, we just ask for an end to the war in Ukraine, for the world leaders to work together for world peace, for Pam and John Holt, whose home was severely damaged by water while out of the country. And Lord, I just ask for your hand on the rest of their trip and protection, and just everything that's gone on. Lord, I just pray for them. Just be with them. Bring them home safely too. And also heal them from their COVID. Please, Jesus. We pray for Joshua Reedson to remain healthy after his recent bouts with pneumonia. Lord, just bless their family this week as they aren't here and at the funeral. And just let everybody stay healthy. For Joan's sister-in-law, Gretchen, who's being kept comfortable with hospice care, and we praise you that she's at peace and ready when the Lord calls her home. Lord, just be with the family as well. For Pete Proctor, who needs to have a nuclear stress test on June 23rd and surgery on the 27th. Just love. Let him feel your peace, Lord, as all this is going on. For Whiskey Bob on his motorcycle trip from Baltimore to the Arctic Circle, just keep him safe, Lord, on the road. For the Frasers who are traveling for a month, visiting family and friends across the country, Lord, I just pray you bless all their meetings and their comings and goings, Lord. For safe travels and wellness, for Jason Miranda as he travels to Switzerland with his friends. God, just keep them safe while they're out there and enjoying the world. For my mom's move from Florida to Colorado, and thank you that she got an offer on her house last night, Lord. Please just bless this cell and help her transition. For safe travels this summer, for everyone who's part of the House Church community, Lord. In your name we pray all these things, Jesus. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Okay, David Miranda, have you reading scripture this morning?
Okay, this comes from Mark 1, 32 to 39. That evening after sunset, the people brought to Jesus all the sick and demon-possessed. The whole town gathered at the door, and Jesus healed many who had various diseases. He also drove out many demons, but would not let the demons speak because they knew who he was. I lost the scripture. Bart, you're on mute. Okay, part two. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up and left the house and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Simon and his companions went to look for him, and when they found him, they exclaimed, "Everyone is looking for you." Jesus replied, "Let's go somewhere else, to the nearby villages, so I can preach there also. That is why I've come." So he traveled through Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out demons. Matthew 25, 31 through 36. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. And I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." Bart, you're on mute.
Thank you very much, David.
Just apologizing for having glitches this morning.
I was just apologizing for those glitches. There's another one. Thank you for being so accommodating. Hey, this is like family together, right? If it was perfect, everybody would thinking about, we've just got to make sure it's all just right. Well, it is just right because you're here. We're here together. We're living on the edge, right? We're living on the edge of technology, Zoom edge. Think about it. The cutting edge of life is where God takes us in order to trust him. Think about that for a moment. Just look at it. The cutting edge of life is where God takes us. We don't always want to be there, but it's necessary sometimes. And God takes us there in order to trust him in situations that are beyond our control. Now, notice this verse from Luke chapter 4, verse 29. They got up, forced Jesus to the edge of the city, out of the city, and led him to the edge of the hill. That was not a good edge to be on for Jesus at the time. And the rest of the story, at least at that point, is he slipped away from them and went on with his business. That's a different kind of cutting edge. But with that, let's just pause and take time to prepare for this message, and that I would like to take time to prepare at this moment with a prayer. Join me, please. Father, thank you for this Father's Day. You are the Father of all fathers, the perfect one. And though our fathers were not perfect, they, in most cases, I think, did their very best. And those that we would call dad, if they weren't our natural fathers, loved us with a kind of love that we are grateful for. Help us to think about you as that perfect father who loves us with a perfect love, draws us to yourself, and wants us to rest in your arms. Help us to do so right now, together, as your children, brothers and sisters, in Christ, through Christ, we give thanks because he is the one, your son, Father, who brought us to yourself. Now open our ears to hear this message so that it is a message that will encourage us and maybe challenge us in various ways, as well as you lead us to that edge of life where we learn the most and yet we are challenged the most also. I pray these things, Father, in the name of Jesus. Well, when you think of edge, what comes to mind? Maybe knife, a knife set. And I'll show you what I pulled out of the drawer for this morning. This is our cutlery set. It's what Dawn uses. I don't use it much, but a knife is really no better than its edge, is it? Okay, I want you to think right now, how sharp are the knives in your drawer? Okay, so we've got a number of them here. This is the smallest one, it's just a paring knife. Now, I don't remember how sharp this is because it's been a while since I sharpened it, but we'll find out. I like bananas for breakfast. I haven't had breakfast yet, so maybe this is a good time to start. And so I always start by cutting it here, and it's going through there a little bit roughly, but able to at least get it started. Here we go. We got the banana started with the knife, but it's not very sharp. Well, it really doesn't take much to put an edge on it, right?
I have to clean the banana off here because you can't sharpen it because there we're going to get food in there.
So I just look at the little instructions here and I run it through this sharpener a few times. Notice, this isn't taking very long. Flavian, Naomi, do you have a knife sharpener? If you don't have one like this, then the knife sharpener is sitting to your right. His name is Flavian, and he will sharpen those knives for you one way or the other. So when we do this, what's really helpful for me, if you would hold this, my right-hand assistant, is that it cuts really, look at this.
That is a banana, honey.
That is, and it's cutting nicely. I know it is a banana, it's not that. Hey, I wanted to make sure it cut well, and it did. But are you getting the point? Okay, literally and figuratively. The point is that a sharp knife is good, okay? Do you want sharp knives or dull knives? I mean, who wants a dull knife in your drawer? So we want sharp knives, not dull knives. Okay, now let's make that question a little bit different. Do you want a sharp life or a dull life? Well, you don't want a dull knife. You want a sharp knife. Do you want a sharp life or a dull life? Well, dull in that sense is a pretty pejorative term used that would make it sound bad. You don't want a dull life, but do you want a sharp life? What does a sharp life look like? A cutting edge life. Well, here's another question to ask. What appeals to you more? Living on the cutting edge of life or living in the comfort zone? The sharp life or the dull life? You know, the comfort zone is the dull life. I mean, maybe you like that, just to chill out, veg out. That's what we call it, just vegging out. So what appeals to you more, the cutting edge of life or the comfort zone? Kind of dull, tranquil. Well, I think for me, it depends. You see, if I'm on the cutting edge too long, I long for the comfort zone. Don't you? But if I'm in the comfort zone too long, I long for the cutting edge. I want something to happen. So there needs to be some balance in there. Now, the first scripture that was read by David this morning from Mark's Gospel, chapter 1, there is a lot going on in the chapter itself, even in the first half of the chapter. I mean, it's amazing. Now, Mark's Gospel is the shortest and considered the oldest of all the Gospels. It's 16 chapters long, and there's a lot going on, and it's happening really fast. The word immediately, in most modern translations, you can count the number of times from verse 10 to 20 or 25. It's appearing, I don't know, 7 or 8 times, immediately. Things are just happening fast. So, for instance, we have at the very start of Matthew's Gospel, chapter 1, John the Baptist is on the scene. He's already grown up. We don't have a creation story. We don't have the lineage of Jesus. We don't have the birth story of Jesus or of John growing up. We have John the Baptist on the scene preaching and baptizing. And as he does so, right there in the early verses, Jesus shows up to be baptized. And as he is, it says, immediately the dove comes, a symbol of the Spirit of God coming and the voice of the Father speaking, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." And then immediately the Spirit sends him out into the wilderness 40 days, 40 nights to be tempted. And then from there, he comes into Galilee. And there he is. Immediately, he is on the shore of Galilee, and he's calling fishermen to come and follow him. Andrew and his brother, who he took to find Jesus, but it doesn't unpack it there in Mark. It's Peter there and Andrew. And they get up, and immediately they follow him. And then he goes and finds two others. This is all happening like in the next verse. John and his brother James, also fishermen, in the boat there with their father, mending their nets. And they leave everything immediately and follow him. And then the next day, it's the Sabbath. And immediately there in the synagogue, it says, Jesus is met by a man possessed of a demon. And the demon says, "We know who you are, the Holy One of God. Why have you come here?" And Jesus drives the demon out. And of course, that's a shockwave to the people that are there. And throughout the course of the day, he is healing people. From the synagogue, it says he goes over into the house of Simon. Simon's mother-in-law is ill. And immediately, Jesus tends to her and makes her well. And so then the whole city comes out to see him. And he's healing all day long. This is the cutting edge, wouldn't you say? Are you getting exhausted yet? I am just here, you know, thinking about it and telling and retelling this story all into the evening. So then what? Well, the word spreads immediately to the countryside. So where are the folks going to be the next day, do you think? Where would you be if you had a sick relative or you were sick yourself? Right there. So what does Jesus do? He's been on the cutting edge. This is exciting time, but it's exhausting. And it says, before the sun rose, Jesus went off to be alone with the Father. His Father's day was every day, probably every moment of every day. No doubt it was, for the union of Father and Son is so intimate, and that's what he's calling us to, and sometimes just need to take a break from the cutting edge to the comfort zone, from that sharp, edgy life to a dull life for a while, to just chill out and relax. But for how long? It's been a while for me since I was serving in the Army as an Army chaplain, and most of my assignments after the 82nd Airborne Division, which was really fast-paced, cutting edge constantly. In fact, it was so much so that I said to myself, at least, I think to my wife, but I was saying, hey, if they send me on another assignment with a unit like this, I'm going to have to bow out. Well, they didn't. They gave me a break. But sometimes they do back to back to back, and that's not healthy for the soldier, and therefore it's not healthy for the military. So they gave me a break, and that was good. But a break too long is not good either. Now, I'm not saying that my life hasn't been action-packed. I think it has for Dawn and I all the way through our career in the military and beyond. But the cutting edge looks a little bit different for all of us because we're all different. And so when the Ukraine situation happened, I started thinking, wow, is there something more I can do? I have never been to a rally before the Ukraine event, and they had a couple of them that Dawn and I went to in DC. Never went to anything like that. But just being around other folks, many of them were from Ukrainian descent, all these flags, it was very impressive. But for me, that's not enough. You know, I wanted to do more. So all of a sudden, one day, I get this message from Samaritan's Purse. We've been familiar with that organization for some time and supported them here and there. But because we're on the mailing list, we get informed of what's going on. And it was talking about Ukraine and volunteers and what they had going on. And I thought, you know what? I think I need to follow up. I'm wondering, is God calling me to step out like this, or is it just me? I want to do something. And so I did, and it was a long process of figuring out, well, I've been a chaplain before, this is what I have to offer. You know, we all have something to offer. And right here, these are all knives, but they're not all the same knife. And this little paring knife that I just used, it's good for, you know, cutting a banana like I did, but it doesn't do the same kind of a job that this does with a serrated edge. And my wife is going to be making bread later on, and you don't cut bread with a paring knife. You use a serrated knife, but they're all knives and they all need to be sharp. And we're all knives in God's little box that he wants to use, and he wants us to be sharp. And so I'm not trying to tell you what yours might be. I have no idea. I'm just trying to take an inventory of me and what I have to offer. And so I applied both to the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association to be a volunteer chaplain, to go to places of a disaster in America, but you got to get there yourself, and then they take care of you, and it's voluntary, and that's really neat. But, you know, I'm really interested in international work because that's been my life. And Dawn and I traveling around a lot of places in Ukraine really appealed to me in that regard. And so I applied for training with Disaster Assistance Response Team. It's called DART, to be a part of a DART. Well, BART, DART, that kind of fits together. What the heck? Why not? No, I didn't really bring that into the picture at all, but I did take a look, a good look at what they offer and what I have to offer. And so I applied. And lo and behold, I got called back and they offered me a position in construction. Now, I have done a little construction work through my life, employed as such before I was in college and during college. That's a long time ago. But I've been a chaplain. But this is what they hired me to be. And so I said, sure, but you've got to be trained now. Well, I just finished 6 days of training in Boone, North Carolina, and Wilkesboro, which I drove back from yesterday, got back at 10 p.m. after 6 days of training. I was incredibly impressed. I just wanted to share a little bit. So this is a bit of my bright spot also, but it's also looking at the cutting edge. And as I'm sharing this, I want you to think about yourself and that sharpness God wants to work in your life and through your life, however, wherever it may be. And the balance that is so important that we see in the life of Jesus demonstrated, and what God also wants us to recognize that we need to take a break here and there. And I need sometimes folks to help let me know. So I'm going to share this screen of a little bit of what I thought was a very impressive experience while over there. Well, first of all, while I was at the campus at Boone, which is also where Appalachian State College is, which is where Franklin Graham attended. And that's when he was, if you will, solicited by a couple of doctors, and the beginning of Samaritan's Purse happened. It was hatched then, just over, it's been about 52 years now. So it's been quite some time. And it's grown. And their campus there now, where I went for some training, mostly from the professionals with a lot of PowerPoint slides and stuff, and all kinds of people from all kinds of places, bringing all kinds of skills, and being around them was a very, very meaningful experience in itself. And then we went to Wilkesboro for the training, and that's right by their storage center. This place is amazing. So I'm gonna share some of the pictures from that storage center right now. But first, this is on the wall going in, and I'm going to read it to you because this is the background. You can see it hopefully there as well. In the footsteps of the great physician, brothers Richard and Lowell Furman were surgeons in Boone, North Carolina, when they felt God leading them to tithe their time and serve overseas as ambassadors for Jesus Christ. Unable to find a Christian organization offering short-term medical trips, they founded World Medical Mission in 1977. The Furmans enlisted the help of Franklin Graham when he was a senior at Appalachian State University. Franklin became the president of Samaritan's Purse, as it was named in 1979, and World Medical Mission is now the medical arm of Samaritan's Purse. World Medical Mission sends hundreds of doctors and other medical professionals on short-term trips for each year, and a medical warehouse was added in 1991 to ship donated equipment and supplies to mission hospitals. That's where they started. And the post-residency program was established in 2004 to raise up a new generation of career missionary doctors. It began to evolve over the years. Dozens of mission hospitals around the world partner with Samaritan's Purse and offer life-saving care to millions of people who otherwise might not be able to access the care they desperately need. More importantly, countless souls have come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior through the witness and prayers of Christian doctors, nurses, chaplains, and staff. As Dr. Furman has said, medicine is the one of the greatest tools for evangelism there is. The more we help to staff and equip these mission hospitals, the larger the platform we have for telling others about Jesus. And it is about, as the slide shows there, on that big banner, delivering hope in Jesus' name. They mince no words, they make no bones about it. We're doing this in Jesus' name around the world in many disaster areas. So this is their facility. It is a mind blower. This is like, am I in Amazon? This is only about 5 years old. So this has been escalating and growing over the past 10 years. All of this stuff is staged and ready to be sent wherever it is needed. It's a state-of-the-art facility. And this is their medical center as set up there. And they said, hey, this isn't just to show people, although they do take folks through tours there. They said, we can pack this up and ship it if it's needed wherever. And you can see household water filters, shelter plastic, blankets, et cetera, all lined up there. These are only some of the pictures. I went through the tent. This is an emergency room setup. That's what it looks like. So they have doctors and nurses and other staff that are managing that. And they do have what's called DART chaplains who take care of the team that is there, much like I did as a battalion chaplain in the Army with the soldiers. All the equipment that's out there. They have about seven of these gigantic vans, and they had all kinds of other equipment in here that they can transport wherever it needs to go in the United States. This was their wing that is associated with domestic emergencies in the United States, and they have staging centers also in Texas and in California. And this guy right here is a highlight from my experience too. His name is Sergey. He's 36 years old. He's been living in America for about 6 years now. He's from Russia, and we had some great conversation. So on Thursday, I guess it was Thursday morning, I hadn't met Sergey. I had just gotten up that morning and I went in to have breakfast, and there he sat. So we had breakfast together. This was just one day. So we got to know one another during breakfast and had a good time. And then we sat together during the training session. And then during the day, I said, you know, I love to go out and go walking afterwards. He says, I'd like to do that too. So it was raining. It was a thunderstorm But we found this mountain bike trail, and it was pretty mucky, but we went and we talked about a lot of things. We talked a lot about Russia, his background. We talked about politics, what's going on there in Russia and the Ukraine. And he desires to go. He cannot because he's still got his Russian passport, but he can go into Poland. He speaks Polish and so forth. Well, I'm going to just stop the share right there and say this other thing about being on the cutting edge. There's a wonderful scripture verse in Proverbs 27, 17, I believe it is, that says, iron sharpens iron, just as one man sharpens another. So you can actually sharpen knives this way. If you don't have a tool, you can sharpen them by running the blades together, and they sharpen one another. And so in this experience for me this last week, and very, very personally, in my experience with Dawn every week with you together, this is a sharpening experience. Lynn, I'm looking at you right now on the screen. You sharpen my life. Joan, you sharpen my life. Flavia, you sharpen my life. And it goes back and forth, and God wants us to sharpen one another. And during my experience there, I meet a guy, and in one day, having breakfast together, and after we went to walk, he said, hey, you want to go out to dinner? I said, well, sure. Where do you want to go? He says, well, I went to this Italian place. He said, okay, let's go there. So we spent really pretty much the whole day together. One day with Sergey, and when I left yesterday, he gave me a big hug. I said, let's stay in touch. One day, one person who happens to be very good at logistics, an area that I am no good at all. In fact, when we went through the logistics training during our 6 days, I asked him, I said, gosh, that was hard. What did you think? He says, oh, I really liked it. I said, you did. And then I thought, you know, we're all different. We all have something different to offer. And in this organization, there's all kinds of folks doing all kinds of things. Some of them go, like I would be deployable to go at a 3 or 4 week interval time, maybe once, twice, or as many as perhaps 3 times a year. Who knows? I don't know. But there's other folks that are stay behind doing other things. Again, the point that I'm making, the point, is that God wants us to be sharpened and ready and available to be used in the cutting edge work that he is doing all around the world, but right next door as well. One other passage of scripture, the second one that David read, and that comes from Matthew chapter 25. For a long time, as I've read that passage, it's just really struck me. I mean, it's the division of the sheep and the goats. The sheep go in one direction, the goats go in the other, into the presence of God and not in the presence of God. And the reason has to do with taking care of people. So with the sheep, why are you calling us to come in? Because I was hungry. You gave me something to eat. I was thirsty. You gave me something to drink. I was naked. You clothed me. I was a stranger and you came to me. I was in prison and you visited me. I was sick and you helped me. We either do or we don't. This is, happens to be an organization that does that. It does it out on the cutting edge. But one of the things that they're very careful about, and that is they don't want you out there too long, any more than a military unit wants somebody out there on the front lines too long. No, they want you to pull back. So let's balance our lives, this cutting edge. And I wouldn't call it being in the dull zone, but the comfort zone as well. But God is calling us not to one or the other, but to both. So let's make ourselves available. That's what the week was for me, which was really a very meaningful, very impressive experience. And what was as impressive as the training itself were the trainers, totally committed people, dedicated first to Jesus Christ and to proclaiming his message and to do it in whatever they had to offer. A gathering of people from all over the country, all kinds of skill sets, but all of us one in Christ, just as we are one in Christ. and it is in him, through his sacrifice, through his suffering, that brings us together. It is through his death, burial, and resurrection, which we have the hope of eternal life. And so we always come to this time, and in this case, we'll close our service with communing. First and always first, with the Father through the Son, and second, in community with one another. So let's join with Jesus in that upper room right now. If you are in Christ and Christ is in you, if you committed your life to the one who gave his life to you, then we're part of this family, brothers and sisters in Christ. So let's go up there with him, remembering that night in which Jesus was betrayed. And right before he broke bread, he said, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. I tell you the truth, I shall not eat it again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. But I want you to continue to do so until I come. So then he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, saying, this is my body given for you. Take this, all of you, and eat it. And as often as you do this, remember me, the body of Christ. In like manner, he took the cup. And after giving thanks, Jesus said, this is my blood. This is my blood. It is of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Take this, all of you, and drink it. And as often as you do this, remember me, the blood of our Lord Jesus, who gives us life. Father, thank you. Thank you. We so often go to you so quickly with all the problems, with all the concerns. This world has disasters going on all over the place and in our own lives, personally, our families. But when we come to you first saying thank you for giving us life, for giving us full life, abundant life. Thank you for even allowing us to go through those challenges. Every bit as much as a knife blade is impacted directly and harshly in order for that blade to become sharpened, so our lives must go through those trials. And you know how much is too much. Help us to know how much is too much also, both with us and others. Help us to just make ourselves available to you. You say, come to me. So help us to come, to allow you to work in us and through us. Sharpen us, Lord, and lead us to that comfort zone when and wherever we need to, but to not stay there too long, but to listen to your voice as you're calling us to whatever cutting edge that we have to offer, where we can be your hands and your feet in touching the lives of others for your glory and for the benefit of others. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all for tuning in. I love you all, Dawn and I both, and we're so pleased to be with you this Sunday, and I'm pleased to be back after a week with my buddy here, and we're going to go off for a walk in just a moment, but first, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Peace to all. God bless and have a great
day. Thanks. Happy Father's Day.
Thank you. Happy Father's Day. Bye-bye.